Right.
Well, welcome back. We are here with our good friend, Harry Boomer from 19 Action News.
Welcome.
Thank you very much.
Friend.
How are you guys doing?
It's so good to see you.
It's good to see you both.
It's
again.
Been a while. I couldn't remember that. We won that cook-off, didn't we?
Yeah, let's just get that straight.
Let me get that straight.
Actually, I won. The Boomer's Delight, People's Choice.
The Boomer's Delight. That's
what was it? What was it? That's right, because you guys were in a celebrity cook-off. And you made Boomer's Delight that was...
Was that the year we made the sweet potato pie? I think we won first place still because we were the only dessert they placed.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, okay, with that all said, now let's talk about the fight. Let's go way back. We're going to talk about Harry for a few minutes.
Mm-hmm.
About his childhood, growing up, going to college, how he got to Cleveland via D.C.
Mm-hmm.
But first of all, we got to share, Cynthia just told me this right before we came on the air, that you came from a city called Turkey, North Carolina.
Yes.
And I know where that is, Harry, because, you know, I'm from North Carolina,
exactly.
Too. So.
Can you imagine a Boomer from Turkey? Unforgettable, right?
Yeah, it kind of has a nice ring to it.
Now, you know I'm about to
bust. You got a joke.
You know I'm about to bust, but I'm not going to do it.
So let's talk about your childhood, Harry. You grew up in Turkey, and at a very young age, you said, you know what? I'm going to be a television broadcaster.
Mm-hmm. First of all, I was a Cabbage Patch Kid. I was born under a cabbage out in the forest. I'm only kidding.
I was really starting to believe
You know, I'm like, if he tell me he's about to chase some chickens, I'm about to lose it.
This is very intriguing.
I have chased chickens, by the way, and love to eat them, by the way. I remember when television was relatively new, they had a news broadcast on the three networks, ABC, NBC, CBS, and it was a 15-minute newscast. And we used to watch NBC. And I remember Chet Huntley and David Brinkley, and I was sitting at the foot of my mother's bed, and I said to her one day, I want to do that. She said, boy, be quiet. And basically, back in those days, it wasn't something that black kids aspired to do because there was nobody on television that looked like me or us. And so it was something that she said, well, try to do something else.
But
mine was made up.
Right, going to education.
You'd be a teacher.
Right.
Yeah. You can go out or preacher like my dad.
Be a pastor.
All right.
You know,
or a lawyer, or a doctor. Maybe.
You know,
right.
But you couldn't be on TV.
That's right.
Okay.
At least, and you know, I didn't try for a long time. I got into radio, and then eventually I made my way onto television. So here I am.
Great. And so when did you decide that, well, I'm going to leave Turkey?
When I realized that I didn't want to go down to the local slaughtering house and work my butt off all day. Like my buddies did. Great living, but I just didn't want to be around killing hogs all day. I knew there was something bigger and better for Boomer, so I caught the Trailways bus to D.C.
I am out of Dodge.
I'm like, let me get out of here.
I got one, but I'm going to keep it.
Go ahead. I love Turkey, but Turkey is in my rearview mirror right about now, and I will come back and visit because that's home. That is home.
Absolutely.
We got a lot more to talk about. I'm not going to go there. So you ended up at Northern Virginia College in Alexandria, Virginia.
Yeah.
So now, did you know you were going to major in broadcasting journalism then, or did you kind of find your way still?
Well, actually, I was in broadcasting. I went to D.C. after graduation, watching television, saw a commercial about broadcast school, went down and enrolled, and got into business. I went down to Carolina and came back, and then I went to Northern Virginia Community College and took some writing and English and those kinds of things, sort of round out the life experience. I've been one of those people who graduated from the University of Life, oh my lordy. Mm-hmm. And so,
I like that. Uh-huh.
Hey, I came up
Please
the hard
elaborate.
Way. Well, you know, it's one of those things where you live and you learn. And if you're fortunate and blessed, like I have been, you put to use what you've learned. God has been good to me, so.
Very good. So now, okay, so at the school, at the college, Northern Virginia, you decided that you would, you know, major in media. And when did you get your first job?
1971.
Mm.
Yeah, I was in
D.C.
That
starts the track. There we go.
Yeah, I was in D.C. Working in the clubs as a disc jockey. I was too young to actually be in the club that I was the MC in, actually. My brother was the roommate of the manager, and they said, come on in. I had a deep voice and a lot of hair and back in the day. And they taught me, and then I just kept going from there.
When you said a lot of hair, I could see a joke coming on.
I'm not going there.
But, you know,
come on.
It's plain to see that I've lost a lot of my natural insulation, but that's okay.
I'm not going to go there because I lost mine too, so go ahead.
It's cool. And, you know, I got into broadcasting. I actually worked in the clubs in a place called the Mark IV Supper Club. We have acts come in 7 days a week, and they do two shows a night. I'd bring them on and take them off and move the mics back and play music for people to dance.
Can you see Harry talking about spinning on the ones and twos?
Did you do a little bit of, you know,
I ushered in that era.
All right.
I was there before rap. I was there before disco. I was there when we only had one turntable and couldn't do any mixing. Actually, we used to take the turntable, put a record on, and when we wanted to change it, we'd talk, use one hand to put another record on, put the needle on, turn it up, and when it hit, we just kept on talking.
Wow.
That was during the days of the 33s and the, what, 45?
45.
You had to put the nickel on it just in case if it skipped. You had to put that nickel right on the needle. You don't know nothing about the nickel on the needle. Had to hold it down, but let's fast forward to 1988.
We can't stay there.
1988, you came to Ohio, and you were in the Northeast Ohio. You were in Canton at that time.
Yeah. My brother's roommate in college at Howard University, where they were in law school together, is from Akron. He bought a radio station in Canton, local boy made good, and he knew I was in radio in Washington and invited me to come out here to run the radio station down in Canton. So I came out here on Wing of a Prayer, lots of dreams. He told me about the big dreams he had, didn't tell me he didn't have any money. And so I came out and, you know, worked at the station a couple of years. It didn't work out to my satisfaction. I like to eat, so I moved to Cleveland and started working at Channel 43, actually volunteering at Channel 43 first before I ever got on air.
Okay, hold on. Because he had to slip in there. I like to eat, but I'm volunteering.
He's from Turkey. I'm from Turkey now, come on. All right.
I'm country fan. You know what to say.
Okay, so there we at Channel 43. Good.
Yeah.
That's a good point.
A buddy of mine down in Canton knew me at the radio station, and he knew the news director at 43. Called him and says, "Look, I got a guy down here who wants to get on television. Can we come up and visit?" The guy said, "Look, I've got 15 minutes. You guys want to drive 55 miles up and spend 15? Come on." We spent 3 hours, and as I was turning to leave, I said, "Hey, Dan, you mind if I come back one day?" He's a boomer. "Come back anytime you want." I was back the next day.
And hey, it's history. The rest is history.
So we do want to share with our viewing audience that Harry has not only won awards with the Ohio Associated Press, the Ohio Educational Telecommunications, the Press Club of Cleveland, and the National Association of Black Journalists. But in 2007, you were inducted into the Broadcasters Hall of Fame.
Yeah, I was so honored and so proud. You know, brought my daughter and her husband and my grandkids up and some other family, and we had a great time. It was a wonderful recognition of all the long nights and hard days and all the driving and all the life I gave up to do this job that I love. Mm-hmm. It was an honor that I cannot, that has not been paralleled since.
Let's talk a little bit more about your time at 43, Channel 19 as well. Mm-hmm. We've seen you anchor. Mm-hmm. We've seen you report, and we've also seen you do a talk show on 43.
Yeah, 43 Forum.
43 Forum.
I try to do it all. I think if I keep all my skills sharp, I'll have a job. If not there, someplace. Mm-hmm. And if I lose this job, I'm going to go out and create a job. I need to, as I urge all of my friends. Exactly. I encourage all my friends to have multiple streams of income. And the best way to do that is to be on your J-O-B, know your J-O-B, be on time, stay overtime, do what you have to do. And that's worked well for me for almost 40 years.
Yeah, that's word to the wise for kids who are coming up and whatever their interest
whether
it be broadcasting or whatever. Mm-hmm. That's very good wisdom, words to live by.
So let's talk about what stories come up to mind that, you know, that has really made an impact in your life?
You know, it's been so many. I remember that I've covered every president since Nixon in one form or another, either in Washington, D.C., when I was news director and talk show host, or when I was in Canton or here in Cleveland. I remember one when our current president, President Barack Obama, made his announcement in Cleveland when I guess Chris Dodd was the first to announce he was going to support him. It was here in Cleveland. I had a chance to ask him a question. In fact, I'll skip a little ahead to 9/11, just 2010. I had a chance to meet the president, shake his hand at the 9/11 commemoration at the Pentagon. Unfortunately, my daughter's uncle died in the Pentagon on 9/11/2001. And every year we go back and do some kind of commemoration. And this year I got a chance to meet President Barack Obama. I met President Clinton and also President George W. Bush as a part of all of that.
You know, one thing I remember, Harry, when you and I worked together at Channel 19, I think President, at the time, President George W. Bush was in town. You interviewed him, and President George W. Bush called Harry by name. He said, "Boomer." I thought, wow, it was like they were on a last name basis. I was like, that had to be pretty cool that he said "Boomer" in the interview. You know,
so wait a minute, Cindy, you work with what is behind the scenes? You need to give me the skinny.
Well, you know what? One thing I can say about Harry is just my years of working with him at 19. He is a hard worker, and everything he said about being on time and all that—that's him, and then some.
And I got to give her some kudos because she sat with me on the anchor desk and let me practice being an anchor. When she was there,
that
gave me an opportunity to get my skills together, which is what I use right now. So I want to thank you publicly.
Thank you, Harry.
Well, Harry Boomer from 19 Action News. I just love what
fair, honest, and everywhere.
Yeah, okay, fair, honest, and everywhere. That's what you want to believe. I'm just saying. All the way from Turkey, North Carolina. And I'm not going to go there with any jokes today. I'm going to keep it clean. Thank you for always taking a look at what you do. You're always welcome to come back.
Yes.
And we got a whole lot more we can talk about, I'm sure. Hey, stay tuned. We have a lot more. We got Stephanie and Rosemary coming up in a few moments. They're going to be talking to another one of our media, personalities here who has been doing great things, got a great book. So stay tuned with more of Another Look.